only 8 other teams in the history of high school basketball in Indiana have done, and that is win back-to-back state championships. You got to go back to those Marion teams of a few years back to get to the last ones to do that.
Bill Green's team in 1975 and 1976.
And, of course, one team won it 3 successive years. That was Franklin in 1920, 21, and 22. And we are set to go with the 1979 Indiana State High School Basketball Championship. And the tap is controlled by the Indians of Anderson. And there, my friend is Campbell, starting right off where he left off this afternoon, and this time he missed it. It is tapped out of bounds, and it is touched last by the Muncie Central Bearcats, wearing that familiar purple trimmed in white. Anderson, the home ball club this afternoon, wearing white, trimmed in red and green. There's the turnaround shot inside by Henry Johnson. Johnson did not play very well this afternoon. He was 1-for-4 from the field, had just that 2-point total, only 2 rebounds.
And a man-to-man defense, Jerry, and Brett Campbell draws the assignment on Ray McCullough.
And that's the way they also began this afternoon, with Steve Avila knocking home the first 2 points of the game. This game is tied at 2. We have played 35 seconds. Inside, good move by Kurtz. While Kurtz gets his first 2 points of the night, and Anderson goes back in front by 2 at 4-2 with 45 seconds gone.
And we see the quickness already of the Anderson ball club.
Sure do. There was a half-court pressure there, and they took it right into it and tried to score.
Rory forced the 10-footer and missed everything, and the rebound comes off to Anderson's Henry Johnson. In a hurry is Brett Campbell. Penetrates to the free throw line and dishes off to Skaggs.
That's the way he started this afternoon.
Skaggs. Go ahead, Jerry.
Skaggs was 10 out of 12, Joe, and they're giving him that open shot again already.
They're trying to hurry it down the floor.
Avila knocks one home. It is a 6-4 ball game.
Doesn't anybody miss?
Loose ball picked up by Muncie Central. The Bearcats have it. Bridges could not hang on to it. It's out of bounds to Anderson.
It looks to me like Anderson is trying to speed up the tempo of the game. They're taking the ball down there very quickly, trying to take advantage of the fact that Muncie played 5 men almost the entire game, plus had an overtime.
Joe, you're exactly right. That's what Norm Hell said that he was going to do in the preview tonight.
Skaggs again. Mercy. Skaggs is a senior at 6'6". The average is 15.1 per game, 7.8 rebounds, 10 out of 12 this afternoon on regular season, a haul of 49% shooter. Here is Carmichael for the first time. Well, I thought both ball clubs shot well this afternoon, Hilliard, but this is a whole new ball game here.
Well, we talked about percentages, but these are astounding.
Open man is Sean Teague, and he hits it.
Had a little confusion on the defense by Muncie that time. Some of the Bearcats were up at midcourt, the others dropping back into the normal zone.
Sean Teague did not shoot particularly well today. He was 4 out of 14. He ended up with 9 points. He has picked up 2 here this evening, and it's a 10-6 ball game as Anderson gets his biggest lead of the night.
Brett Campbell is really on Ray McCollum.
Well, McCollum was sensational this afternoon, deflected partially by Kurtz, but Muncie Central comes back to get it. Kurtz got the rebound, bounced the ball on the baseline, and it goes back to the Anderson Indians again. You had a look at Bill Harrell, the fine head coach of the Bearcats of Muncie Central High School, a graduate of Kentucky Wesleyan, the University of Kentucky, coached Shelby County of Kentucky to the Kentucky State High School Championship back in 66. Finally, Skaggs misses one. Rebound, Kurtz won't go. Rebound still being fought for. Kurtz gets it, but it's taken away from him by Johnson, and he puts it up and scores. Johnson with 4 points, and Norm Held in a beautiful plaid jacket looks on enjoying what he has seen so far.
Gary Muncie will have to keep Anderson off the board.
Timeout has been called by Muncie Central. 4:40. Young ladies there have a 12-6 lead showing on the scoreboard in favor of their Indians with 4 minutes and 45 seconds of playing time. In the first period, that's Rory inside to Carmichael. Carmichael's second bucket of the ball game. He's the top shooter on the ball club at 61%, also 83.5% from the free throw line. 12-8 to score. Muncie Central trying to get back into the ball game. There's the tap up by Johnson. Wouldn't fall. Reaching in foul will be called, I believe, on Skaggs. We'll wait for the official's designation.
Pat Skaggs is behind it here. Let's look at the hand, see if it goes on the back. I believe it, yeah, his right hand. Look at his right arm on his back, right over there on the other side there. It's a good call.
Back to live action. Number one foul of the evening. Stags picks it up. No shots involved, of course. We are down to 4 minutes and 10 seconds in the opening period. They lob it inside to Carmichael.
Got to have some weak side help now. Anderson got to get some weak side help. They're looking for that lob. Both sides of the floor.
Walking violation, lane violation. You see the score, or saw the score. It was 12 and 10. And now Muncie Central has it with a chance to come back to a tie. It's been tied three times, at 2, at 4, and again at 6. And here comes Steve Avila, one of three returning lettermen of the Central Bearcats basketball team. Rory over to McConnell. He has yet to break the scoring ice this evening after a great afternoon game. Superb defensive play by Sean Teague. The junior on the break gets it off the glass and scores. Sean Teague has field goal number 2. His brother John was a starter on the Sanderson Indian basketball team last year, now playing for Boston University. 14-10 score. Back in front by 4, the Indians of Anderson. Avila being guarded closely on the near side by Teague. Here's McCollum's first try, and he's got it. So McCollum has not cooled off any from this afternoon when he hit 10 out of 11. There's a delay in the game. The official now taking a close look at number 20, Steve Avila. I think he might have thought that Avila got poked in the eye, and now they're going to take a look at Troy Bridges. Bridges coming over now to Rick Peckinpah. That is Rick in the left of your screen in the plaid jacket. Bill Harrell peeking in to see what the situation may be.
Turnovers are 2 apiece, Jerry.
Looks like he might have got hit in the mouth, Jerry, or a rebound there. He's all right, that big fella. He's not going to hurt him hitting him now. He won't feel that till tomorrow morning when the championship's over.
And if they win it, he won't care about it.
Oh.
14-12. Anderson has the lead. They have the basketball. You see Brett Campbell bringing the ball up court along with Sean Teague.
Four corner. They're going to bring him out of the zone. I wondered if Norm Held would try this, and they're matching up going to a man-to-man defense immediately.
Campbell comes to Teague and back to Campbell again. Inside 3 minutes, first period. Almost a steal by Avila. Bring it back out to Lyle Kurtz again and quickly over to Campbell. They want Brett Campbell to handle the basketball as much as possible. Penetration by Sean Teague. Dunks it off, and there's Johnson. Well organized, Joe. Well executed.
Beautiful. Sean Teague cut to the middle, went by Ray McCollum, and dealt it right off to Johnson. Pretty play.
So the Indians got back in front by 4 again. Avila bounces it inside, and there's a great move from Troy Bridges for his first hoop of the night. Only Rick Rory has not scored as far as the starters are concerned.
I think maybe we've seen the last of the 2-3 zone defense by Muncie, unless they get ahead.
It is still Brett Campbell and Sean Teague looking inside to Johnson and Kurtz and Skaggs. Muncie Central with McCollum and Avila guard, and Bridges and Rory and Carmichael along that front line. A minute and 48 seconds to steal. Here comes McCollum trying to get control. Dishes it outside to Bridges. Back inside, a whistle and a walking violation called against Troy Bridges.
It looks like Steve Avila has a laceration in his mouth, and I'm not sure he's going to be able to continue. As you can see, he's in a little bit of pain right there.
You don't suppose those two collided? They were looking at Avila and also looking at Bridges at the same time, and they had to work on both of them. If there was a collision, I did not catch it. A minute and a half to go in the first period. State High School Basketball Championship is on the line at 16-14. Anderson's Indians going for their fourth state championship against the Muncie Central Bearcats going for their seventh. A minute 10 to play in the period. Steve Avila in a hurry. Right down the lane, dishes it off. Here is Rory. Great defensive play by Pat Skaggs. Quickly up court to Campbell, deflected away, and a superb defensive play on the other end from Troy Bridges. There were two purple shirts up court, and they couldn't get it there. Avila with the basketball. Comes to Carmichael, 14 feet out. Rebound and a whistle. And the foul is against the Anderson Indians. It is on Skaggs. He has number 2.
It'll be on Pat Skaggs now. Watch him going right over the back of Avila here. There it is. Reaching right over.
We have played almost an entire period. That's just the second personal foul. And both have come against Pat Skaggs. McCollum, they cleared the left side, and McCollum beat everybody. Second bucket for McCollum. We're tied up at 16.
Anderson has turned the ball over five times.
21 seconds to go in the period. Anderson will play for the final shot of the first period. Now it's down to 12 seconds. I'll make it 10. You can hear the Anderson bench calling it off. Pete couldn't get it. We have 3 seconds, 2 seconds, one. That is Bridges off the mark. That's the end of the first period. It's tied at 16 between Anderson and Muncie Central. One of your network hosts is the Coca-Cola Bottlers of Indiana. See that the Muncie Central cheering section intact this afternoon is right back here again tonight as we return to live action. Top scorer for Anderson, 6 points, Henry Johnson. For Muncie Central, likewise, 6 for John Carmichael.
Anderson has outscored Muncie Central 10-4 since it was 12-6 in favor of the Indians.
Along with Hilliard Gates and Joe Sexton, I'm Jerry Baker. This is period number 2, and the tap control by the purple of Muncie Central, and right away they go into the lead. Muncie Central goes in front for the first time this evening.
Now we'll see the zone defense again.
Skaggs couldn't get it, and that's Carmichael. And it's taken away, and putting it up is Sean Teagan scoring. Carmichael came down with it. Ben committed the unpardonable sin of looking around to admire his handiwork, and Teague stripped him beautifully.
That was a nice steal there by Sean Teague.
We're tied at 18. Here's McCollum being defensed and also being fouled by Sean Teague. For those who did not see this afternoon's ball game, McCollum was simply sensational from every conceivable part of the court.
Showing how quick that Ray McCollum is there, Sean Teague just couldn't stop him. Kept him from getting all the way to the hoop, though. Got a foul.
Well, the Bearcats have it again. Here's McCollum working out back with Avila. They go across to Bridges, and here comes Rory out to help out. Rick Rory. Mr. McCollum again.
There's one you won't see very often. A lob pass to a 5'9 guy.
Alley open, 5'9.
Doesn't take long for Anderson to answer the call, though, with Henry Johnson's 8th point of the night. I'm not sure I've ever seen that before, where the 5'9 guy goes up like McCollum did and gets the alley oop pass, but it's obviously a planned play. High ball game of 20. Shows 6 minutes and 40 seconds to play. Here's the foul on Campbell. Basket will not count. They indicate the foul came prior to the shot. And Brett Campbell has picked up personal foul number 4.
Here we go now. Watch the fake now by Ray McCollum to get Brett Campbell up in the air. There's the fake. He gets him up in the air, but he doesn't get the shot off soon enough to get 2, so they take it out of bounds.
Inbounds, Triggerman is out. Right in front of us here, out to McCollum. Neither club has gone to the bench as of yet. In fact, Muncie Central probably will not. They throw it away, and it is saved right into the hands of 21 Sean Teague. Right side to Campbell, and the rebound back to Teague again. Muscled away, knocked away beautifully by Troy Bridges. Troy Bridges, a letterman, as I mentioned, one of only 3 on this club, including John Carmichael. Strips the ball away, and the Bearcats have it again.
That's the 3rd basket that they've scored. Coming away from the ball, a block on the, along the lane.
First period, both teams hit exactly 57%.
Pat Skaggs from downtown with a half a dozen now. Skaggs on the season, only a 49% shooter. That's not much to write home about. But he was sensational with 10 of 12 this afternoon. He has 3 field goals and 6 points thus far this evening. Swings the ball the other way, and McCollum gets free. It won't go this time, and Kurtz has got the rebound. We are tied at 22. 3-on-2 advantage on the break. Here is Skaggs. Won't fall. Up by Kurtz, and good.
That was a nice fast break, Jerry, by the Indians.
Number 15.
And the Anderson Indians move back in front by 2 again, at 24-22, with the clock showing 5 minutes and 14 seconds to play in the half. Avila, top of the circle. Henry Johnson, only 6'2", but Norm Hell says he plays a lot taller than that. The Stags won it again.
The word incredible.
Hold it. Somebody has just thrown something on the floor down here. There's some debris. And I'm not sure where it came from. It came out of the Anderson cheering section, or at least in that vicinity up there. So there'll be a little delay in the game while we pick up some of the paper. What else do you have, Hilliard, first period-wise?
Well, in the first period, Muncie Central took 14 shots, hit 8. Anderson taking 14 and hitting 8, each 571. Neither team was at the foul line in the first 8-minute bracket of this game. Jerry and Joe, the outside shooting by Anderson has been phenomenal.
It really has, and it's stayed over from this afternoon's ball game, and both of these clubs shot exceptionally well. As Hilliard mentioned just a few moments ago, Anderson shot 55.6 this afternoon, and Muncie Central 51%. You're looking up into the Anderson cheering section, and apparently that is where the wad of paper came out of, and you can see the police, Market Square Arena, very well handled in that area. Trying to find the guilty party. Here's a travel violation called against the Bearcats. Steve Avila. So the Indians will bring it up. Campbell and Teague.
Turnover number 6 for the Bearcats.
Really not bad, all things considered, the pressure of the situation.
Now, even though it's man-to-man, they've gone to the four corner again.
We're down to 4.5 minutes in the half. And it's a 26-22 Anderson lead. In the first period, the Indians were up by 6 at one point of the game. Ball called out high. No, they called the ball being turned over by Anderson. The turnover gives the ball back to the Bearcats again. McCollum and Avila looking up court to Bridges and Rory and Carmichael. And break Bridges down low, and he comes off the other side to get it, and a whistle. And an offensive foul. And I don't think it's on Bridges. I think it may be on Rory.
It is on Rory, Jerry.
Number one on him, the first against Muncie Central, so they went 1.5 quarters without committing a foul. There is the man in charge of Muncie Central, Bill Harrell.
He's trying to get position on the pivot, and he just backed into his defensive back.
Clock running down. It shows now exactly 4 minutes. You may have been able to hear Norm Held. You can probably hear him in the background yelling, go wide, go wide. That's Teague rolling off the rim. Rebound by Carmichael.
So Central blocking out a little better right now off the defensive board.
Anderson tried to give Muncie a little of their own medicine there. They put Sean Teague on the top, like Ray McCollum was on top in the high post area this afternoon.
Carmichael in and out. Rebound. Back up, and it won't go again. And now we'll get a whistle and a foul. And they have stuck the foul on Troy Bridges of the Muncie Central Bearcats, his first of the night.
Interesting play here. Troy takes it up there. Can't quite get it in, and then goes over the shoulder to commit the foul. That's a tough situation.
Muncie Central 23-5, 15-5 in regular season, 8-0 in the tournament. Anderson's Indians now 22-6. They are 14-6 in regular season play. And at one point lost 5 out of 6 games on the season. Almost stolen away, but recovered by Campbell. Here is Skaggs, penetration this time, and he got the hoop beautifully. Skaggs has 10 points tonight. He had 24 points to go along with 9 rebounds this afternoon. His average is 15-1.
That's 8 consecutive Anderson points without an answer.
28-22, Anderson back in front by a half a dozen. That equals their first period lead. Carmichael, oh, great defensive play by Henry Johnson at 6-2. Teague takes it away. The baseball pass comes up court to Campbell. He hooks the pass back down to Johnson, and he scores. Johnson with 10.
Muncie Central has not scored in more than 3 minutes, Jerry.
What a superb defensive play, Joe, by Henry Johnson.
It certainly was. He came from the opposite side to give weak side help and block that ball. And then they ran another great fast break. They're scoring on the break.
2 minutes and 30 seconds to play in the half. McCollum. He has 8 points. He averages 11.6. He went for 26 in this afternoon's victory over Terre Haute South in overtime, 60-55.
Once again, they're putting Sean Teague on the high post now.
Walking violation. Substitutions now for Muncie Central. Number 13 is Rick Level. Number 24 will be Fred Long. And a timeout has been called with 2 minutes and 10 seconds to play in the half. It is Anderson 30, Muncie Central 24. One of your network hosts is Farm Bureau Insurance. We are back now at Market Square Arena in the heart of downtown Indianapolis, Indiana for the state high school basketball championship.
Muncie Central went scoreless for 3 minutes and 39 seconds of that period.
Muncie Central has made some changes. Avila to Carmichael. Rolls off the rim and the rebound yanked out of there by Lyle Kurtz. Rick Level, Fred Long are in the lineup now for the purple and white of Muncie Central High School. A minute 45 to play in the first half. Excellent move inside by Teague. Sean with 8 points.
That's the very reason they set up like that.
That is an 8-point margin now for the Indians of Anderson High School. The largest lead that either club has enjoyed. It's knocked away across the way in that mass of some 50-plus radio stations beating this tournament game tonight to every nook and cranny in Hoosier land and then some. Level. He is a 5'10 senior. Long is a 5'10 senior also. That is number 20, Steve Avila, a 6-foot senior. A minute 18 to go on the half, and Anderson has jumped out in front as they go inside, and a great long pass to Troy Bridges.
What a nice pass. Long.
That's only Troy's second field goal. As I mentioned this afternoon, he was 5 out of 10 from the field, 11 points and 10 rebounds. Precisely a minute to go, and a great steal by Rick. Becomes the first substitute for Muncie Central to score today. And, as a matter of fact, in the last three games, because nobody played in a championship game of the Hinkle Fieldhouse Semi-State when they won it against North Central.
Turnovers are 7 apiece.
Air ball put up there by Skaggs. And the Bearcats, with 32 seconds to play in the half, have a chance to chop that lead. Deflected away, superbly so by Teague. Picked up by Brett Campbell. Campbell comes near side to Kurtz, but a whistle blows the ball dead prior to the hoop. Out of the top of the free throw circle. And I believe Campbell will go to the line on the personal foul, which is tacked on to number 21, Troy Bridges, number 2 on him. So that's only the third team foul, though, so there will be no shots involved. And another substitution for Muncie Central, number 10, Greg Moeller, comes into the ball game. Moeller coming in, Avila going out. Steve leaves the lineup with 2 field goals and 4 points. Now Skaggs will get a bit of a respite. Pat Skaggs comes out with 10 points on 5 field goals.
Good foul by Troy Bridges there. They take the ball out of bounds. They for sure had a 3-on-1.
Reed Estes, number 31 in white, is the substitute in for head coach Norm Hell, the senior at 6'3". His father, Ray, was the head coach of Anderson for a long, long time. Offensive foul with 12 seconds remaining in the half.
A charging foul on Brett Campbell.
And number 2 on him.
All right, watch Brett drop his shoulder here now. Ricky Level guarding him, and he shoves away with that right hand. That was a good call by Roger DeYoung.
We are down to 9 seconds now and a half. It's 32 to 28. Long in the corner, can't get it. Teague on the rebound with 1 second to go. Fires in the midcourt stripe, and it almost went in. And that is the end of the first half of play. It has been a beauty. And it's still anybody's basketball game, as they love to say. At halftime, the Indians of Anderson High School, 32. The
perimeter, but knocked it inside very well to Carmichael, so we can anticipate that they're going to knock it in a little more, and also we can anticipate that the Indians are going to hustle them into man defense.
McCallum has made 4 out of 5, and Johnson 5 out of 6.
We're suddenly on out. Pat Skaggs, 6'6 senior, will step in against John Carmichael, the 6'5 senior from Muncie Central. And the second half is underway, but there's a stoppage already. Somebody got up too soon, or somebody stepped in the circle. And I believe the guilty party will be number 21, Sean Teague of Anderson. So the Bearcats start off with the basketball in the second half. They are down, as we mentioned, by a score of 32 to 28. I think they have gone back to their original starting lineup with McCollum and Avil at guard and Bridges and Laurie and Carmichael up front. Excellent move by Carmichael inside. Joe, just what you said they were going to do.
Dumped it right in there. He chased that ball all the way across the lane. They swung it around the perimeter and hit him inside.
Carmichael with a 15 run per game average, had 17 this afternoon. He had 6 points in the opening period tonight and has not scored since then until that basket you just saw.
Excellent move by Campbell. Couldn't get it to fall. Rebound comes to Steve Avila, and now the Bearcats have a chance to tie officially for the sixth time in the game. McCollum way off his driving foot, comes into the lane, gets the hoop, and gets the foul. It is on T, I beg your pardon, it's on Skaggs, and that's number three on him.
Watch this, he comes right across the lane and hooks this ball now to get it off over the 6'6", Pat Skaggs. Now, Pat, if he would have kept his hand up, as we've talked about before, maybe he wouldn't have gotten the foul, but he brought his arm down, and you saw it right there, a chance for the three-point play.
Eight consecutive points here by Muncie Central.
And the first free throw attempt of the night. And Muncie Central has jumped in front by one. McCollum has 11 points now. Oh, Carmichael and Rory inside. Oh, great play. Number 15, Lyle Kurtz picks up points, number 5 and 6. And Anderson jumps back in front by a 34-33 score. Just moving inside 7 minutes in period number 3. McCollum, penetration, stops at the free throw line. Carmichael, good shooter from there. Won't go this time, though. And the rebound comes off to Campbell, and Campbell may have walked with the basketball. And he did, and I'll tell you what happened there, Joe. Nothing more than the fact that Steve Avila was standing right where he wanted to go. Now, watch him come out of here.
Watch Steve Avila now do a good job, and he forced Brett to take that extra step. And of course, that's the foul.
Rory has it. Now that's Avila. Back to Rory again. We're down to 6 minutes and 35 seconds in period number 3.
Anderson's turned the ball over 10 times.
Rory, the 6'5 sophomore, has his 6th point of the night. He shot only 1 out of 5 and had just 2 points this afternoon. 35 and 34, Muncie Central. Good move inside by T. Going to find the defensive play by Carmichael. Stolen back by Skaggs. Pat will go up and get clobbered. And Carmichael will pick it up and also help pick Skaggs up. Carmichael with personal foul number 1. And now, for the first time tonight, Joe Sexton, Anderson will make a trip to the free throw line, and Pat Skaggs will have the shots.
Pat Skaggs, that was a good example of a guy knowing exactly where the defensive man was. He faked him up in the air. Let's see if he gets the 2 shots. Yes, he's going to get the 2.
Pat Skaggs, a 67% free throw shooter, hit 4 out of 6 this afternoon. Skaggs down with 11. It is a 35-35 ball game. 7 times, the game has now been tied. Skaggs with an even dozen points. 6:05 to go, period number 3. Have a look as Anderson comes and gives some full court pressure. Nice pass up court to Troy Bridges, and he knocks it home. Bridges has a field goal now in each period.
That's the first time that Anderson had used the full-court pressure, and Muncie went right at it.
37-36, Sean Teague dishes off left side. That's Henry Johnson.
That's Ryan Johnson.
And that's 12 for Johnson, and we're right back in that shooting scheme again, Hilliard.
Well, he's only missed one of this whole game.
Both these clubs really putting on the kind of performance you like to see in a game of this importance and caliber. Carmichael turns off the edge of the rim. Anderson has it. They are up by 1 at 38-37. This is Henry Johnson. Off the Skaggs and a lane violation called against number 15, Lyle Kurtz. Kurtz got in the middle, got entranced with the action going on outside, and the official caught him with a lane violation.
What happens there, Jerry, is one of his teammates went up for a shot, and then a defensive guy got on. He had to pass it, so he got stuck in the lane and got a 3-second call.
5 minutes, 10 seconds to play, third quarter. Anderson out in front by 1, 38-37. Steve Avila, A-V-I-L-A, to McCollum. They drop it inside to Carmichael. He's double-teamed. He may have walked with it. He did. You can see the official, Jerry Petro, right on top of the play. Jerry working along with Roger DeYoung tonight.
9 turnovers now for Muncie Central.
It is a 1-point ball game. Anderson trying to add to their 38-37 lead. Henry Johnson at that free throw line. In and out. McCollum's got it. In a hurry. He beats 3 of the Indians up court. They weren't watching. He takes the shot and scores. Joe, he actually caught the defense and went by them that time.
Yes, sir. He made some great penetration there, pulled up and went straight up for his jump shot, and he's just hitting them all.
They got the ball inside of Johnson, and Troy Bridges picked up his third foul of the evening.
That's the third foul on Bridges.
It's a nice pass now. He throws that ball right in there. But Troy comes over the back there. Troy Bridges, 21, fouls loud. Right.
Back to live action. Back to Brett Campbell tossing it in and going long range to Skaggs. Skaggs may have picked up the offensive foul. And if indeed he did, that is number four.
Let's watch Rick Rory now and see if he's set. He certainly is.
And now with Skaggs picking up his fourth personal foul, Norm held up his hand. There's Norm talking to Skaggs, but Joey's going to leave him in.
He's wondering. He's contemplating what to do.
Well, that's a tough decision because we got half of the third period and all the fourth period to play.
Let's see if Muncie gives the ball into Carmichael now. Skaggs guarding it.
Avila's looking at Carmichael. Now McCollum swings it the other side. Now here it goes. Rory may have walked with the basketball again. And very quickly a substitution for Anderson. Reed Estes, 6'3 senior, will go into the lineup. There is Reed. And naturally, Pat Skaggs will come out. Skaggs comes out with an even 12 points. I mentioned earlier that Reed Estes, who was in the ballgame in the first half, is the son of Ray Estes, who was a coach at Anderson and a great one for a number of years. 3 minutes, 45 seconds to play, third period. Way off the mark is Campbell. Rebound comes quickly out and up court. And one of the Muncie players is down. Avila missing. The rebound comes up to Campbell. It is McCollum who is still up court and maybe slightly injured. And two more bodies go down. And the ball is out of bounds. And McCollum wants the official to take timeout. There is McCollum down on the floor. Joe, what did you see?
I saw referee Roger DeYoung call a foul, a charging foul on Brett Campbell.
Now you're looking at the bottom of your screen, Ray McCollum, the 5'9 senior number 12, who has just played sensationally today. He is nursing an ankle. He went down hard, managed to climb back up when the teams came back up court, tried to get into defensive position. When the ball went out of bounds, he went right to the official. You could see him pleading for the timeout. Then he went down hard and is still lying there. And I do hope it's nothing serious. It's the right ankle. They're going to take him off the floor. Ray McCollum now leaving the floor. He'll be taken down into the Market Square Arena training facilities. And they've got some of the best in all of sport through that entryway where they're going right now. This, of course, is where the Indiana Pacers play professional basketball. Their fine head trainer, Davy Craig, has a complete layout of every conceivable type of equipment down there.
Jerry, Muncie Central's biggest lead has been 2 points, and Anderson's biggest margin to this contest has been 8.
Norm Hell just checked, Joe. There was no foul called on that play.
That's right. I heard the referee say it was a dead ball before the foul. Ricky Levels in there now, Jerry.
The Bearcats are in front by one at 39-38 with 3 minutes and 12 seconds to play in the third period. Rory inside. Rick Rory's 8th point of the night. He averages 8.3. He had just 2 this afternoon. And Muncie Central Hilliard, I think, has their biggest lead of the game. 3 points.
That's
at
correct.
31 and 38.
They had a previous lead of only 2.
Anderson appears to be wanting to eat up some clock here while their leading scorer, Pat Skaggs, is out with 4 fouls, Jerry.
This is Henry Johnson.
Henry said, I'm hot. We're not going to hold it any longer.
Henry Johnson with his 14th point of the night pulls him back to within 1 again. It's 41 to 40. Muncie Central. 2.5 minutes to go, third period. Carmichael inside, and a blocking foul is tagged against Anderson's Reed Estes. Estes picking up the personal foul. There is Norm Held. He's not very happy. Those bright red slacks and that green and red plaid jacket.
Let him bully his way in there.
Troy Bridges underhands it up and scores. 8 points for Troy. Back to a three-point lead at 43-40, Muncie Central. Excellent defensive play by Rick Level. Level is fouled by his counterpart 13, Brett Campbell, number three on Campbell. And Joe, momentarily, it appears as though Anderson may be losing a little bit of its poise.
Well, let's watch here now. Ricky Level makes a nice block, takes it. Now watch Brett Campbell right at midcourt, give him a shove with the right arm.
And a timeout has been called. It's 2:04 to play in the third period. 43-40, Muncie Central, one of your network hosts, American Fletcher National Bank.
Afternoon too.
Yeah. This guy's better than the other one.
Good.
Muncie Central Bearcats have the basketball. They also own a three-point lead at 43-40. We have 2 minutes and 4 seconds to play in the third period. Avila done a good job running this ball club, though not scoring a great deal this evening. Rory dishes it off to Bridges. He's good from right in there. Won't get it this time, though. And the Indians clear the boards with Sean T. Here is Campbell, and he turned it over, I believe. Yes, he did. You see head coach Norm Held of Anderson on your screen asking, what did he do? Norm is a rather active young man.
Volatile? I'm
1 minute and 44 seconds to play in the third period. He is trying to get his ball club out of the doldrums. They have gone into a little bit of a nosedive the last couple of minutes. 43-40 is the score. That's probably the part of the shot that they have put up so far this evening, they being Muncie Central. Rick Level took that one. Anderson with the rebound. They swing it right side to Estes, and back out they come to Teague. And now they go to Campbell. We're down to a minute, 15 to play, and Campbell will let it go. The rebound pulled up by Troy Bridges. Anderson's just not getting any second opportunities. Avila in and out. Two of the white shirts of Anderson off the boards to bring down the rebound.
The Indians need to get settled down here on offense. Good. See, now Campbell says set it up.
Henry Johnson's board and he scores. Henry Johnson was 16. He has scored 6 of the 10 points this period for Anderson. 43-42. Anderson climbs back to within one. We are down to 32 seconds in the third period. Let's see what Muncie Central wants to do here now. Norm Held yelling out to his ball club, close it up, close it up.
He wants to close up the middle there, Jerry, not let him drive through the middle. Of course, we'll have something new with McCollum out of there.
Down to 12 seconds to go in period three. Avila has it knocked away. Behind the back to Kurtz, and he walked with a basketball. Campbell's pass was right on the money, but I think it surprised Kurtz a little bit, Joe.
Tremendous pass. I don't know if he needed to do it or not. 2-on-1.
4 seconds. 3. Here is Bridges. They got it! And the bucket will count. Troy Bridges from just across the timeline. And after 3, it's Muncie Central 45. Anderson 42. There it is again. Boom! One of your network hosts, the Coca-Cola Bottlers of Indiana.
But they miss Skaggs, I'll tell you that, don't they?
He's almost got to come back in, doesn't he, Joe?
Yeah, he's coming in now. McCollum is back, Joe.
Is he back? Take it, Joe.
How much we got? 30 seconds? What happened prior to that? Did we get a travel, or what did we get there for him to get the ball?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, he threw it behind the back pass, yeah, and he knocked it out of bounds.
Out of bounds.
Yeah.
Here's that long shot now by Troy Bridges just as the third quarter ended. Banked it.
And you never know just how important a shot like that might be, Joe. Not just on the scoreboard, but the emotion that sets in when your ball club is only down by one, and a fraction of a second later, you're down by three.
Smart move by Norm Held. He's got Pat Skaggs right back in there.
And Ray McCollum is back there.
Right on. Number 12, Ray McCollum, comes back into the ball game. I can only assume they took him down, checked his ankle out. They may have retaped it or taped it very tightly, and he is back. We'll see how effective he may be. They need him in the lineup, as does Anderson need Pat Skaggs in there. Fourth period is underway. We're 8 minutes away, perhaps, from crowning a state champion. Anderson defeating Argus 74-64 this afternoon. Muncie Central over Terre Haute South 60-55 in overtime, and a great basketball game. Here is the steal. Here is Campbell in for his first. Oh, he missed the shot. Campbell has not scored a point tonight. He had 13 this afternoon. His average is 8.9. He is the captain and the floor general of this ball club, and now the foul is called on Sean T. Number two on Sean.
Looks like he may put a little spin on this ball. He protects it a little bit. Should have gone.
Joe, it didn't look like he went right to the hoop. He kind of went off on an angle at the last second.
He took off on the wrong foot and turned his body. That's right.
Avila goes to the line. Hillier, take a look at the stats we have for you to this point.
Well, up to this moment, Anderson hitting 49%. Muncie, 55%.
Steve Avila. His first free throw attempt, his first successful one, of course, of the evening. Steve now at five. His average is 11.3. He had but four this afternoon. He leads the club in assists and in steals and now has 6 points. Muncie Central being led in scoring by Ray McCollum with 13 and Troy Bridges with 10. Anderson only has two players also in double figures. Henry Johnson with 16 and Pat Skaggs with 12. Pat is back in. He has the basketball right now. He did not get a field goal in the third period. Turnaround shot, no go by Teague, and there's good position inside from Troy Bridges again. Bridges plays baseball. He is a muscular young man for this Muncie Central basketball squad. He may not score a lot, and he's only 6'5", but he does an awful lot of things awfully well. 47-42, the Bearcats have their biggest breathing room of the night.
Jerry, this is what we talked about prior to the start of the game. Now Muncie controls everything. They control the tempo of the game. They have that lead now. There goes the lead now.
Well, I don't know what you can say. Ray McCollum has his 15th point of the night, and that time he was simply sensational. He filled that middle beautifully and got the shot, but they come right back, and Johnson gets it back on the other end for his 18th point of the game.
I don't think he's missed in the second half.
I don't think he has either, Billiard. 49-44. The game plan basically for Bill Harrell, as we mentioned earlier this afternoon, is to get ahead and make the other team play your game. Here's the steal and a foul. It is on Sean Teague. That'll be three on Sean. We have mentioned Bill Harrell, and he is the kind of a guy who is about as intense as his Norm Hell. So you get two great coaches going after each other.
You see Sean trying a position, and then he reaches in and right over the shoulder there.
Timeout call, 5:59 to go in the ball game. It's 49, Muncie Central, 44, Anderson. One of your network hosts is Farm Bureau Insurance.
Anderson hit only 33% of the third quarter. think an oddity, too, is the fact nobody has missed a free throw in this game. All the free throws have been only two by Anderson and three by Muncie Central.
Who's shooting the free throw shot?
Who's going to the line?
Who's going to the line here? Avila, 15. Hilliard, you being from Fort Wayne, you actually started up in Fort Wayne the tournament play this year on a Monday. Everybody else started on Wednesday or Thursday. 395 teams. The largest was 787 back in 1938, and the smallest, 12. 1911. You recall that?
No. Joe was telling me about it.
Was he really? That was the first Indiana State High School basketball tournament in 1911, where they had 12 teams enter that year. Here is Avila. Steve Avila, 3 out of 3. Hilliard, an interesting observation. Nobody's missed a free throw tonight.
That's right. All the free throws have been taken, have been converted. Two by Anderson and three, four, five by Muncie. Now six.
Steve Avila has picked up 4 points this period. That equals his entire first three-quarter output. Total of 8. Now it's a 7-point lead for the Bearcats of Muncie Central. And a walking violation gives the ball right back to them again.
Well, that's 12 turnovers now for Muncie Central. 17 for Anderson, and that's a lot of errors.
And a lot of those have come in the last 5 or 6 minutes of play, Joe Sexton.
Yes.
They have lost some of the momentum.
They've lost their timing on their offense. We talked about it a few minutes ago, and they just haven't gained it back.
Rory penetration, dishes it back out to Ray McCollum. McCollum will take it inside and take the shot, and no, it won't go this time. Rebound cleared out by Anderson. Lyle Kurtz off to Campbell. They need some scoring from Campbell. They go inside. Bucket will not go for Sean Teague, and the foul on the follow-up. And that is the final foul on that young gentleman. Pat Skaggs may have just played his last minutes of high school basketball. He started off hot again tonight. He fouls out of the game with 12 points, 10 of which came in the first half of action.
Tough for Anderson to lose him, but here, let's watch and see how Pat Skaggs fouls out here. There's the drive by Sean Teague. Can't quite get it in there, and here comes Skaggs. Looks like over Troy Bridges' back.
As we come back to live action, we come back with a score, 51-44. Troy Bridges with his 11th point of the night.
They get you down, they don't let you out, do they?
It's a 9-point lead, of course, the biggest lead for either ball club. Muncie Central is devastating with any kind of a margin. Henry Johnson, again, deep in the corner, has his 20th point.
Give the ball to Henry.
That's what it's going to be, apparently, because he's the only guy with any kind of consistency right now. McCollum showing no ill effects of that damaged right ankle that came toward the end of the third period. Rory gets inside and comes back out again to Avila. Clock shows 4 minutes and 52 seconds to play in the ball game. Avila. Oh, they run this offense very well, Joe Sexton.
Oh, they're tremendous with it. Hey, this is it. They're just controlling the entire game now.
Carmichael thought about going to the hoop and then changed his mind. Avila. Rory. Now to 4.5 minutes to go.
Last year's starting five have departed, and this is a rebuilding job.
The defensive job by Brett Campbell was sensational, and we'll jump it up at midcourt, and Anderson wants timeout. With the score, 53 Muncie Central, 46 Anderson, 4:20 to show in the fourth and final period. We'll pause. One of your network hosts, American Fletcher National Bank.
Jerry, 23 and 43 have come in now. You know, and McNeese has played some, and he had to bet. Yeah. But obviously, to get a little quickness in there to try to start.
Bring it up. Shut it up.
You know, probably.
Okay.
Yeah. This is trying to. They're going too fast. They're just not settling down.
Yeah.
Never have got settled
into their offense in the last 7-8 minutes.
Muncie is smart, Joe. They're smart kids.
Tremendous.
Why don't you point those out, Joe, when we come back, the substitutions?
I don't know who they came in for.
Okay, don't worry about that. Just mention that they're in. We'll pick up who
okay.
they're in.
They're giving or assisting. We don't know which one.
Got a couple of substitutions here for the Indians now, Jerry. Tim McNeese, number 23. And Gary McGee, number 43, obviously feeling, Coach Norm Held feeling that he's going to have to get some more quick guys in there, and I'm sure we'll see him chase them all over the floor now to try to get that ball since they're down now by 7 points.
McNeese injured his knee in the semi-state at Lafayette. He was hobbled somewhat there, but is back in the lineup, and Anderson got the tap. They need a couple of really quick hoops. Campbell to Teague, penetration, and he got it.
Nice pass by Campbell, and here we are, full court pressure.
Sean Teague with 10 points. He becomes the third Anderson Indian to finally hit double figures. 4 minutes and 2 seconds to go, and Muncie Central wastes no time in getting back in that spread offense. Ray McConnum, number 12. Now 25, that is Rory. Rick Rory. Out of Bridges and back to Rory again. We've cut it down to 3 minutes and 45 seconds, and it's 53-48, Muncie Central. The Bearcats looking for their seventh state championship, and a jump ball has just been called again, as again Brett Campbell does a good defensive job. A peek into the Anderson Indians huddle. That is Norm Hell, a very active man. That 33 you're watching is Henry Johnson. Norm Held getting assist from Jerome Foley, a graduate of Ball State. Also Lanny Rieger from Ball State, and Dick Maynard, a graduate of Anderson College.
Joe, didn't Norm put some chasers in there, some kids off the bench just to run after the ball?
Yes, he did. Tim McNeese and Gary McGee, right.
Hertz, number 15, comes out of the lineup for the Anderson Indians with a half a dozen points. Johnson is back in. The captain called by Anderson. Teague couldn't get it, and Muncie Central did, and now with 3 minutes and 20 seconds to play, they'll come back down and spread it out again. Here is a foul. No, timeout called prior to what could have been a foul. Muncie Central says, let's talk it over. 3:16 to play tonight. 53-48, Muncie Central out in front. One of your network hosts is the Coca-Cola Bottlers of Indiana.
Pronounced Mayhem, is that right? Oh, yeah.
Okay. I'll read these top ones. I always say these till the end out here, yeah.
This isn't over yet.
Put your name in there.
No, huh? They're getting back with it now.
We're going to summarize the scoring at the end, right?
Out here? Okay.
3:16.
Well, we might. Then again, we might not. Like to talk about the tough North Central Conference, and I guess they're right this year because both these clubs are members of the North Central Conference. It's the fourth championship game between two North Central Conference teams, 1929, 34, and 52 were the other three. Muncie Central getting the better of tonight's action between these two fine ball clubs. The Bearcats beat them earlier in the season back on the 12th of January. 86-77, Muncie Central ranked number 3 in the state at that time has turned the ball over. That was also the beginning of the demise of Anderson as they lost 5 of their next 6 ball games. And they dropped from number 2 in the ratings, completely out of the ratings. They finished up the season at number 19. Out of the lineup for Anderson, number 43, Gary McGee. And Henry Johnson is hobbled a little bit with a bad right foot, but he's got the basketball and the turnaround shot.
Got him in there just in time, didn't he?
It is like a Chinese fire drill in front of our broadcasting vantage point. Norm Held is racing his substitutes down to the starter down here.
He puts Johnson in for offense and McGee in for defense.
I've heard of platooning, but this is a kind of strange. Now Johnson comes back out of the ball game after picking up the personal foul, his first. And they put McGee right back in there again.
All right, let's watch this foul now. Bridges throws that ball right into Carmichael. You can see there's the foul, reaching right over.
53-50, it's a three-point ball game. Muncie Central with the lead, John Carmichael at the line. Carmichael getting his first free throw tonight. Carmichael started out red hot, Hilliard, then tapered off. He now has 9 points.
Well, that interrupted six consecutive points by Anderson.
10 points. Muncie Central has only one field goal this period. They have 8 free throws in 8 attempts, though. That's kept them in the game. Good move. Sean T now with 12 points. Anderson really beginning to take it at Muncie Central. You wonder where this was earlier in the game. Here is a reaching in foul on Sean T. I've got him for 4. And again, a substitution. Henry Johnson coming back in and McGee going out.
That's right. They foul him now. They have to be careful. There's plenty of time. They're only 3 points down with 2:16 to go, Jerry. They have to be careful fouling the guys. The problem is that you're so aggressive, you're trying to catch up, and occasionally you're going to make a foul. But they need to be a little more cautious and not foul a guy at midcourt.
Of course, Joe, the other thing that needs to happen is they need to change the rotation of baskets right now, because Bill Harrell will be content to give one to get one, and that's what is happening right now. Avila from the free throw line is 6 out of 6. They've all come in this period. And there are the 2 points for Muncie Central. Here is Johnson. Won't go this time. Rebound pulled off by 32, John Carmichael. 2 minutes to play. 2 minutes to go. Here's the steal. It's 3-on-1 on McCollum. They come to Kurtz and he scores. Wild Kurtz with his 8 point. It's 57-54 again. Muncie Central had a 9-point lead at one stage earlier here in the fourth period. 1:45 to go. 57-54, Muncie Central. They continue to spread the floor to try to kill some time. And a loose ball picked up by McCollum. They lob it to Carmichael. Carmichael's shot is good. Great bucket under pressure from John Carmichael. He has 12 points now. 59-54. Muncie Central, 1:15 to go. Henry Johnson. Rebound, Rick Rory. And now the Anderson Indians are in big trouble. Play. 1 minute. Jump ball is called. Again, good defense employed by number 23 for the Anderson Indians, Tim McNeese. Norm Held wants timeout. With 55 seconds to go, the score is 59-54, Muncie Central. And while we have a pause in what has been a tremendously impressive and hard-fought basketball game, we'll thank the technical and production crews who have worked so hard for us all day long. Our executive producer is Don Tillman. Our producer this evening is Michael O'Rourke. Our director, Peter Mago. Network coordinator, John Petritis. Slow motion replay, Dick Blair. Video by Jim Miller and Ken Houchin. Fred Lawrence with the audio tonight. The camera people are Mark Emmons, Bob DeLong, Harold Reitner, and Beth Ephraimson. Our floor director again, Dean McDowell.
An oddity, Joe. And Jerry, the fact there have been 12 free throws taken in this game, all have been made, 2 by Anderson, 10 by Muncie Central.
You know, the ones that Muncie have made, they've made a lot of them late here, Hilliard, and they've been very, very pressure-packed free throws, and they, as you say, they have not missed a one. So it's very important to their 5-point lead that they have now with just 55 seconds to go.
Both ball clubs below their normal offensive output over the season. Anderson averaging 77.5. Muncie Central 70.6. Highest winning score in a championship game. That happened in 1955. And Christmas Addicts of Indianapolis beat Gary Roosevelt 97-74. And the lowest winning score back in 1928 when Muncie defeated Martinsville 13-12.
Big possession here. Anderson has to get the ball now to get back in this game.
And they do. That is Sean Teague, T-E-A-G-U-E. To Kurtz and back to Teague. Here is Campbell for his first of the night. Campbell gets his first 2 points of the ball game. A near steal, loose ball, picked up and it's thrown away, and maybe a foul. It will be on Campbell. Number four on him. And Joe, I think had Anderson been able to be a little more patient, they might end up getting the basketball.
Well, they saw that loose ball. They saw that loose ball and saw a chance then to draw within one if they could get that ball and put it in the hoop, Jerry. And you have to give them credit for going after that one. And put them right back in the ball game.
As Norm Hell continues to hold court at this end of the court and Bill Harrell at the other end, Anderson will take timeout. I'd like to have the cleaning on the clothes of these two coaches because they really get out and scruff around.
Well, it's redundant to talk about the importance now of this free throw because a three-point ball game with 37 seconds on this free throw gives Anderson the chance to come down the court.
59 to 56. Muncie Central looking for its its seventh state championship and looking to become the ninth team to win back-to-back titles. The others are Wingate, Lebanon, Franklin, who won it three times, Washington, Evansville, Bossy, Muncie Central, Chris Posadix, and the Marion Giants, who won it in 1976 and again in 77 under Bill Green. There have been five undefeated state champions. We will not have one tonight, of course, because Anderson's record is 22-6, Muncie Central 23-5. In the past 14 years, we've had 12 different champions. In fact, 47 coaches have won championships. Glenn Curtis, Everett Case, and Marion Crawley each won four. Bill Harrell, you see on your screen, is working on number two tonight. And Norm Held on the other end of the court, working on number one. Joe, last week at Hinkle Fieldhouse in Indianapolis, this youngster right here went up there and hit a couple of very important free throws against Indianapolis North Central. Ray McCollum.
Looks like he's going to do it again. Remember last year, we had reruns of sorts here with Jackie Moore. Remember, he just kept knocking in those free throws right at the end.
Trester Award winning Jackie Moore was here tonight, too. Now playing at the University of Nebraska. 17 for Ray McCollum to go along with the 26 he had this afternoon. 33 seconds to play. Here is Sean T. Can't get it. Rebound fought for, whistle. Maybe on John Carmichael of Muncie Central. And on John, that'll be personal foul number two.
Number 32 of Muncie.
And that will send Henry Johnson to the free throw line. Henry Johnson has not been there yet tonight.
All right, here we are now. T going up with the shot. And then you can see Johnson on the inside, and there's Carmichael over the back.
Well, there will be no foul shots. The bonus is not in effect yet. Into Kurtz. Wild Kurtz with 10. 61 to 58, 18 seconds to go. Defensive play and a foul on Henry Johnson, who very quickly goes over to grab Ray McCollum to make sure he is not injured. A devastating defensive play. Joe, let's maybe pick up on this again.
All right, let's watch Henry Johnson now. Watch him coming all the way across the lane now. There's Ray McCollum going up with the ball. He doesn't even get that ball out of his hands. Johnson cannot allow him to get it out of his hands. If he makes that, it's all over.
Here is the youngster, the 5'9 senior. Leads the club when it comes to situations where they've got to have the bucket or they need to protect the ball. This is the guy who does it.
He's made 9 consecutive free throws. All in this period.
To 58. Won't fall. Follow-up shot won't go either. We're down to 9 seconds. Muncie Central on the verge of picking up the state championship. The foul is against Anderson. It's on Lyle Kurtz, his first. And the celebrating has already begun across the way in the stands of the Bearcats of Muncie Central High. You can see him in the far part of your picture. He is telling all of his players to get back at the other end of the court. Meanwhile, Norm Held will take his last timeout. 6 seconds remain. It is 62 to 58. The Bearcats of Muncie Central, Joe Sexton, need only make a free throw perhaps and start the celebration in earnest.
Or even if they miss now, with that being the last timeout for Anderson, why, if Anderson should get a rebound of a missed free throw and come down, Muncie could stand out of bounds for the 5 second limit that they would have. So for all general purposes, it's history, and the Bearcats are back-to-back state champs.
Well, the last time Anderson led in this game was 36-35, so Muncie Central has pretty well dominated the second half. It was 42-45 at three quarters and 32-28. Anderson on top at halftime.
I don't think there's any question, but Anderson missed Pat Skaggs dearly. He fouled out with 5 minutes and 23 seconds to play in the game, and that took away almost all of their outside firepower.
And set out for 3:56 there on the third quarter. So that's when Muncie made their run. And then, as we've said before, they just controlled the tempo of the ball game after that.
After the game, Hilliard Gates will be out on the floor rounding up some more bodies, particularly the winning coach, Bill Harrell. And I think he set a new record today. You've talked to everybody I can think of.
Including the elevator operator at the hotel.
That's true.
With the microphone, we had an audience of two.
Here is Troy Bridges. And Troy just turned out the lights. Down at the other end of the floor, the other four Bearcats are waving at their fans, and they've begun the celebration. It is all but over. 5 seconds. Here is Sean Teague. He gets the bucket, but it's too little, too late, and the game is over. And the Bearcats of Muncie Central High School have won the 1979 Indiana State High School Basketball Championship. The score, the Muncie Central Bearcats 64, the Anderson Indians 60. One of your network hosts is Farm Bureau Insurance. Okay, do I stay here or go out on the floor? Okay, got you. You have to tell me when Hilliard's ready, because I have no idea. I can't even find him out there. Did you get McCollum for? Did he make both those free throws?
Missed one. Mary missed the last one. Yeah.
All right, you tell me. You could see the celebration going on. Of course, that's Anderson, and they're not particularly happy at this moment, but you can feel the emotion in the air. They climb up on the stands. Head coach Norm Held. You must understand that there's going to be a winner and a loser. 395 started out. When you finish in the final two, my friend, that is a pretty darn good effort. They have been state champions three times. They've been in the final game now seven different times, third to Lafayette Jeff. Briefly in scoring before we go out and see what Hilliard Gates has for us. Muncie Central led in scoring with the 18 points of Ray McCollum. Troy Bridges chipped in with 14 points tonight. 12 points from John Carmichael and 10 out of Steve Avila. So four of the five starters in double digits. Rick Rory added 8, and the other two out of Rick Level coming off the bench. For the Anderson Indians, four players in double figures, led by the 22 of Henry Johnson. He had a half a dozen of those in the final period. They had 14 points from Sean Teague tonight, 12 points out of Pat Skaggs, who fouled out with 5 minutes and 23 seconds to play, and the other 2 points from Brett Campbell. Lyle Kirch tipped in with 10 tonight. Quarter scores, it was tied at 16 after period number one. It was 32-28, Anderson out in front at halftime. At the end of three, Muncie Central had grabbed the lead 45-42, and in the fourth period of play, they managed to hang on to the lead and win it 64-60. Joe Sexton, an interesting note, in the fourth period, Muncie Central, as you look at Bill Harrell at the bottom of your screen, scored only two field goals. The rest of their point output of 19 points came from the free throw line.
Well, Jerry, they did such a tremendous job in their open offense or four-corner, whatever you want to call it. And Ray McCollum came back after that injury, and he handled the ball. They just didn't take that many shots. And so then Anderson, of course, got behind and had to foul him. And that's how they came up with so many free throws and so few field goals. They just didn't shoot the basketball. They were just taking care of it. And like we said, and I've said it too many times probably, but it's so true. And it's why they're the state champs. Once they get up on you, then they control everything.
You're looking at the Bearcats of Muncie Central High. They have begun to celebrate the runner-up trophy you see on your screen, now being presented to the Indians of Anderson High School. They will finish up the year 22-7. Muncie Central will finish up 24-5. We are going to try to stick around. I think we'll have time to pick up the winner of the prestigious Trester Award. And that'll be coming up very shortly. The Anderson Indians, obviously saddened by this experience. Nonetheless, they can hold their heads high. Joe Sexton, as I mentioned, when there are 395 to begin with, and you finish up number two, that isn't a bad outcome for you. Now they make room upstairs for the Bearcats of Muncie Central High. Looking at their cheering section on the other side of the floor. That's the reason their backs are turned, and there is that cheering section. I mean, they brought them out in total mass force today. One of the problems that they encountered, of course, was how to get the tickets out to the people. What a great tradition at this school. They become the ninth school to win back-to-back state championships, and they now have won seven. And you can bet, Joe, that Anderson is hoping next year when they go to play them that they don't hang that, put that championship banner up again.
You don't think they'd fuss with that 2 years in a row, would they?
No. You can see Bill Harrell patrolling the background there. He's got that southern drawl. He's a fierce competitor, a taskmaster, if you will. And right now, the state championship coach, he is up on the podium, along with the principal, James Pugh, the athletic director, Merrill Hole. Donald Slaughter is the superintendent of the Muncie Schools. Now the awards being passed out, placed around the necks of the various players of the Bearcats of Muncie Central. It is absolutely the biggest high school sporting event in the nation. And it is one of the greatest honors possibly that can be heaped upon you to be named a member of a championship basketball club. And Joe, I think even in this modern age, we tend to become rather blasé about everything. This is a highly emotional moment for the moms and the dads, the school persons, and the kids themselves.
Now you can tell by the looks on those Muncie Central Bearcat faces that there's nothing blasé about winning the Indiana Boys Basketball State Championship.
The final score again was 64-60. Hilliard Gates is out and about on the arena floor. He'll be getting some persons to talk with as soon as we have an opportunity. And you can hear the Bearcat fans yelling, "We're number one. We're number one." And indeed, at this moment, on a Saturday night, March 24th, that they are. The handshakes continue. The congratulations continue. The tears continue to flow on both sides of the floor. The unhappy tears, the Anderson cheering section, and of course, victory on the Muncie side of the floor. Again, your top scorers. Henry Johnson led Anderson with 22. Muncie Central with 18 points from Ray McCollum. Let's go out now to Hilliard Gates. Well, Hilliard is trying to get the coach straightened away and fighting mass confusion out on the floor. He is trying to reach Bill Harrell. And as soon as Hilliard gets set, we'll swing it out there to him. the gigantic trophy hoisted proudly in the air.
You know, Jerry, it's great to see them all get a hand on that doggone trophy, because this is a team that had excellent teamwork. Not a real outstanding player. They just knew that teamwork is what would take them to the state championship.
There's Bill Harrell. There's the school song of the Muncie Central Bearcats. They're trying now to make contact. He shakes hands with Commissioner Ward Brown. And now, I believe Hilliard's got him out on the floor. He's trying to work his way down to our floor camera. We'll be going out to him briefly. Hilliard, if you can hear us, you've got it.
Well, we have it. Here's Bill Harrell, who is successfully defending his state basketball championship. Bill, I know winning it the second time here has to be even greater thrill than the first time, but a sensational job, and your youngsters did what you told them to do, and they responded beautifully. Congratulations.
Great little group of kids, huh? I think they really played a fantastic game. And, you know, we're real happy. We're just happy. We're very fortunate. We're very humble. But we're really happy.
Bill, we're going to take the Trester Award here. Will you excuse me for just a moment? We'll pick this up right now.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
The award is named in honor of Arthur L. Trester.
This is Bill Breck from Franklin, Indiana.
Fine Association. The award is based upon scholarship, leadership, athletic ability, and mental attitude. The candidates must be recommended by their high school principal. They also must be seniors. As you would expect, each of the nominees was truly outstanding. As the name of the winner is announced, we would ask that the young man's principal escort the parents of this recipient to the playing floor so that they too may share in this moment. The winner of the 1979 Arthur L. Trester Award for Mental Attitude, Malcolm Cameron of Terre Haute South.
Cam Cameron out of Terre Haute South, a senior at 6 feet 3 inches tall, a three-year starter, an all-state football quarterback headed for Indiana University, a straight-A student, averaging 14.3. Cameron had 8 points this afternoon in a losing cause to the Bearcats of Muncie Central High School. Malcolm Cam Cameron now making his way to the platform area, that red hair glistening in the distance, and Hilliard will make an effort to talk with Cam Cameron, I am sure. Cam Cameron out of Terre Haute South High School. The Arthur L. Trester Award. There is Cam Cameron, head coach Gordon Neff, E.V. Holt, the principal of Terre Haute South, likewise there with him, as is Charlie Moss from the commissioner's office. Joe Sexton, you won it. What does it mean? How does it feel?
Well, I'm sure it's a wonderful experience for Cam. He got knocked out, you know, this afternoon, and so the agony of losing this afternoon's game, you know, is somewhat tempered from the standpoint that he didn't have to lose in the championship game and then get the award. It's awfully tough as I think back, having lost in the championship game and then get the award, Jerry. So I think it's a little different situation. He can smile, you know. The hurt of that afternoon loss is over to some degree. Won't be over for a long time.
There is a good shot of the good-looking youngster, and I'll guarantee you that Lee Corso, the head football coach at Indiana University, is waiting with bated breath to get a hold of him. Hilliard, you got him.
Well, here he is, Malcolm Cam Cameron, Terre Haute Southside, Trester Award winner, 1979. Cam, congratulations. What are your thoughts at this moment?
Thank you very much. I'm really thrilled to death. I had no idea, and, you know, we had tough luck today, but, you know, we got a great team and a great bunch of, you know, individuals on our team, and, you know, I just wish we could have come through, but, you know, I'm really happy, you know, to accept this award. Really, it's just a complete surprise to me.
Cam, I don't know whether you saw halftime here tonight, but 40 former winners of this award came back, and they stood proud here today and tonight, and you'll be among them, and that has to be a great thrill for you.
That is a thrill. I know Jackie Moore, I've idolized him ever since I played against him last year. And I know of all the other great individuals that are Trestle Award winners, and I just really feel privileged.
Well, you joined an illustrious group, but you deserve it because your credentials are such that you can take a place alongside of all these wonderful athletes, and student scholars and great citizens. I know about your background in Terre Haute, and you deserve this award, and congratulations to you.
Thank you very much.
Before you get away, what are your plans now? Do you know what you're going to do?
I'm going to IU to play football.
Attaboy. What position do you play in football?
Quarterback. I'm a quarterback.
You're going to try for Lee Corso's team, huh?
Yes, sir.
I have a feeling we'll be seeing you in the fall.
Yeah, I hope so, at least.
Congratulations. You're a fine young man and a great athlete and a fine citizen. Good luck to you.
Thank you very much.
That was Cam Cameron, and each of your parents, I'm sure. Mrs. Cameron, Mr. Cameron. Congratulations. How are you?
Good.
We've been friends for years.
Oh, for years and years and years. We sure have.
Tell me about your feelings. I know your wife's feelings. How are you?
Just great.
Is this a great feeling? Well, you're very proud of this young man, and I am too, and I've seen him from a distance and up close too, and not as often as I'd like to, but you deserve great congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you.
And congratulations.
Thank you. Well, it's a great honor for him, and I'm very happy and very pleased that it's occurred.
You know, I'm just trying to think if this has come to such a close friend of mine as Cam is and you people are, but I'm delighted and congratulations.
Well, you know, we went through the wars when I was coaching at Indiana State.
That's
and,
right.
So this is one of the pluses.
Well, good luck and congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. You get yourself composed now, will you? Okay, back to you, Jerry.
Thank you, Hilliard. Now let's pause for this special message from the Indiana High School Athletic Association. All right. Okay, I've got the disclaimer to run, and so just tell me when I got a minute to go. All right, no sweat. If Hilliard gets somebody else, let me know. We'll rip it out to him. Did Hilliard get Norm Held on? I didn't hear that. I must have missed that.
I don't think so. Here's Norm here.
I didn't think he got him either. Don said he did.
Here he is. Hey, Norm.
Stand by. Let's go back out to the floor again. Hilliard Gates has the losing coach of the championship team, Norm Held of the Anderson Indians.
Well, we have Norm Held here. Norm, you made a tremendous ball game of it, and I was very close to your bench, and I saw you maneuvering offensively and defensively, substituting offensive and defensive substitutions, and you really got back into the ball game. You cut it down to 3 points, but it just got away from you.
Well, it certainly did. You know, when you outscore a team 5 field goals like we did in a state championship and you lose, it really is heartbreaking, and I think that those were the statistics, and for the game, we shot 2 free throws.
I noticed that, and there was only 1 free throw missed in the entire game.
Well, the amazing thing about it on the free throw situation is we've got the lead and got the basketball, and we're going to the basket and we don't get any, and it's really hard to understand, but you hate to lose the state championship under those circumstances. I don't want to cry, but at the same time, we did outscore them 5 field goals.
The loss of Pat Skaggs was a tremendous blow to you, wasn't it?
Big blow to us, without any question. We needed Pat in there offensively, and also he was guarding Carmichael, and he's our leading rebounder for the season, so he had a great game and a great tournament, and we played a great ball game to watch. I don't think anybody went away disappointed, except the Anderson people are disappointed we didn't win, but I don't think anybody can be disappointed in the game itself.